But today we're going to conclude our series on gratitude. Now, I can tell that you guys look a lot more healthy this week than you did last week. You guys seem to have gotten some nourishments in yourselves, and you look so much more, just excited for today. How many of you ate good this week? All right. You know, one of the good things about the holidays, the good thing about the holiday is that a lot of those old family traditional recipes come out. You know what I'm talking about? Like my wife, she has mastered a couple of my favorite meals from my mom. She's mastered mashed potatoes. Man, my wife has just, my mom made killer mashed potatoes. My wife has mastered my mom's recipe for mashed potatoes, okay? Then the second thing that she's gotten really good at is pecan pie. And whenever the holidays, hey, listen, no. That may be the recipe in your house, but in my house, it's my mom's recipe, and it's pecan pie. And so, like, if you eat pecan pie, you probably put Cool Whip on top of it, too. But, that's wrong. All right, and so where I come from, and my recipe is pecan pie. And so my wife has mastered it. But how many of you know, I would just like to know the people who sit down and come up with recipes. You ever think about recipes? Like, who was the first person who decided, hey, we should put a couple of eggs in here? Like, it doesn't seem to go together. Or maybe we should put some vanilla in this or whatever else. And so they're working through these random things that doesn't seem to go together. But when you mix them all together and you add them to a process and you add time to them, these things that are random that doesn't seem to go together, sometimes bitter and sometimes sweet, they become a beautiful combination. How many of you like hot cocoa? All right, a couple of us. Now, listen, it's almost that time. I mean, it's ish. Hot chocolate, hot cocoa season-ish in Texas. And you better hurry up and drink it this morning because it's going to be, we're going to need ice cream this afternoon. But I love me some hot cocoa. Now, I grew up and my grandmother got things from the government. We had government cheese. We had government peanut butter. We had government, that's what they called it in those days. It was the brown containers, you know. The government macaroni and cheese was kind of sketch. I wasn't into that. But I'm pretty sure we had government-provided hot cocoa. And so it kind of looked like, and it didn't say hot chocolate, it said hot cocoa. Well, one day we didn't have any hot chocolate, and so I went to the pantry, and I pulled out the Hershey's cocoa. Some of you guys know where this is going. This and this, though they may share the same name, are not the same. Like, this has some of this, but it doesn't taste like this. And so I put a big spoonful one time in some milk, thinking I was going to make me some hot chocolate. And boy, was I offended at the taste of that. If you've never had this, I'll have some spoons, and you can try it at the end of service. And it's not like the Hershey's chocolate syrup that goes on your ice cream. Let me just tell you that. This is not the powdered form of the liquid form. It's a completely different thing. It's bitter, like very strongly bitter, to the point that it's repulsive. And so you're thinking it's like going to be something great. But listen, like when you mix this with a little bit of sugar, and then you add some more sugar, and then you go back and you add a cup of sugar and a little bit of water, this can become this with a whole lot of things. I want to talk to you for just a few moments about this idea in life where we wish sometimes that life were always sweet. But in order to have the sweet things and the good things in life, sometimes it requires the bitter things in life. What would a chocolate cake be without cocoa? Without that bitterness, it just wouldn't be the same. And there are some things in your life and in my life that are bitter, that by themselves, they're difficult to stomach. They're difficult to take in. But with a process and with time and with other ingredients, God and the kitchen and the chef brings them together to create a beautiful masterpiece that is wonderful when the process has been completed. Now, in this series, Gratitude, A Reasonable Response, what we've talked about is that there are certain times in our life where gratitude is just a reasonable response. We began that first week and we said, gratitude is a reasonable response to the goodness of God. God's been good to us. We said that gratitude is a reasonable response to the benefits of God. The psalmist says in Psalms 103, Lord, all of your benefits that you have brought towards me and on me and to me, and you've just been faithful in that way. And then last week we talked about that generosity is one of the things that God provides towards us, and that it's natural. It's a reasonable response that we are grateful for the generosity of God given towards us. But here's what you and I both know, is that there are some places in life where gratitude seems unreasonable. You see, it's reasonable to give gratitude and to express thanksgiving to God and to others, to doctors, and whenever the doctor's report comes back good and the cancer's gone, the tumor shrunk, the surgery was successful. It's reasonable to give thanks and gratitude to God whenever you've prayed for the perfect spouse and he or she comes along and it's a beautiful thing, and you prayed for children and they were born completely healthy and everything was just perfect in that. It was the Ken and Barbie family. It's been moments where you say, God, it's reasonable to give thanks whenever the job worked out just like you thought it would and it was successful and you were successful in it. You went into the interview and at the end of the interview, you walked out with a welcome packet. It would seem that gratitude is a reasonable response. But when the doctor's report comes back and the surgery wasn't successful, the tumor didn't shrink and the cancer isn't gone, when that marriage that you prayed for and that you thought was God's perfect will and you gave gratitude and gave thanks for, whenever it ends in divorce, a very painful, bitter divorce, whenever you walked into not one, but you've walked into 10 jobs this week and you've interviewed and there's no callback, but the bills are still due. Those are moments when it seems that gratitude is unreasonable. And this morning, I want to talk to us for just a few moments from this idea and this sermon in a sentence, and it's this. When gratitude seems unreasonable, we give thanks for the nearness of God. Because God does not leave us and he will not forsake us. If you have your Bibles, you can open with me or you can open up our app to the book of 1 Thessalonians. This book is written by, this letter is written by Paul to a group of believers in Thessalonica. In Acts chapter 17, Paul and Silas travel to this region and they begin to preach the gospel, and there are a certain number in the synagogues who receive the message of Jesus Christ, and they receive and accept the gospel of Jesus. And their lives are transformed, but the Jews in that region did not want to hear the message of Jesus, and so they begin to persecute them and to stir up problems. And so then they begin to speak in the marketplace, and that there were Greeks who accepted Jesus Christ through that process. But whenever the animosity and the persecution became so high, Paul and Silas had to flee in the night to get away because it was too hostile of an environment for them to continue to preach the gospel. But God, in his great mercy and his great wisdom, allowed a church to be developed in that. Even though there was difficult times, and even though Paul and Silas were there only a short amount of time, they were able to establish a church with this group of believers. And so Paul finds out about this church and he continues to seek for them, and he actually has a strong desire to visit them. He tells us that in 1 Thessalonians. He says, I've tried oftentimes to come to you, but Satan himself is resisting me and I can't make it to you. But he says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, but here's what I've heard. What I do hear is that your faith has grown and it's expanding, it's reaching around the world. Your faith is making an impact. But Paul's writing to this group of believers because there are some things that are working into their lives and some struggles that they're having. And one of the things that he's going to say to them is that as believers, we have to understand that trials will come in life. You know that to be true by now. If you've served the Lord at any amount of time or length of time, you know that there's going to be some moments in life where things just aren't working out like you thought they were. There's going to be some opposition and some persecution, perhaps, some rejection, some bitterness. There's going to be some tough moments, trials. Secondly, Paul says in this letter, he says, ultimately, there's going to be these trials that are going to come, but there's also going to be temptations that are going to come. How many of you ever had to deal with, some of you dealt with temptation this week at the dessert table. And some of you did not overcome. You went back twice. Let me put my hand down. And so we face temptation. And so Paul says trials will come, temptations will come. But here's what we love 1 Thessalonians for. We love 1 Thessalonians for chapter 4. In fact, Pastor Brian read this passage last week. Because 1 Thessalonians says, and Paul says through this letter, hey, listen, not only will trials come, not only will temptations come, but Jesus himself will come. He's coming again. And so it is this breath of hope in the midst of difficult moments. It's this breath where we can give God thanks for his nearness in the midst of those moments when it seems like he's so far away. If you have your Bibles, you can follow along. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. This is not an unfamiliar passage for most of us. In fact, some of us actually even posted a version of this for Thanksgiving on your social media. You can read it out loud with me if you like. It says in verse 16, "Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God for you in Christ Jesus." Father, we ask that you would anoint the reading of your word and that your word would come to life, Lord, that it will not be print on pages, but it would become the living word of God that's speaking to our hearts, stirring our faith, encouraging us in perhaps some of the most difficult moments of our lives. Lord, this is your will for us, is what the scripture says, that we would rejoice always, that we would pray continuously, and that we would give thanks in all things. God, I ask that you would anoint these lips of clay, that I would be able to speak your word in a way that would impact our lives. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And all of God's people said, amen. I want to give you what I believe is one of the most simple scriptures and passages that Paul gives us, what I call the recipe for gratitude. It's actually so simple that I'm just going to take an hour to explain it, but maybe two. We'll see. We'll see how you react, okay? If you guys do better than that, we'll go for 45 minutes, but if not, we'll go for 2 hours. But it's so simple that we could put it together, but yet it's difficult to live out. The first thing that Paul says is a part of this recipe for gratitude is that we are to rejoice always. It's important that we look back and we understand that we don't rejoice for all things. We don't have joy in all, but we can't have joy in all things. I was remembering just so many times this passage. I've heard Pastor Doug preach on this passage. In fact, as I was studying, even this week, I went back, and some of you have watched me for years. I sat on the front row with my iPad, and I have taken notes in both services. Even though I've heard the message, I took the notes again. And so I searched through all of my notes, pulling up the words that Pastor Doug has spoken from this passage. And one of the ones that stood out to me this week was that he talked about the difference between happiness and joy. And he says, happiness is oftentimes connected to happenings. That when happenings are good in our lives and they're fortuitous, they're wonderful, they're on our side, that happiness, it seems, naturally flows with that. But when the happenings aren't in the way in which we thought that they should be, or they're not in good fortune to us, then our happiness dissipates and it goes away. But joy is different. You see, happiness is circumstantial. Joy is not. Joy is spiritual. The scripture tells us, Paul writes, that when Christ comes into our heart and our life, whenever the Holy Spirit comes to live within us and dwell within us, he gives us the fruits of the Spirit, which include joy. And so joy is not based upon what's happening around about you. It doesn't mean that everything's perfect and that life's not bitter. It just means that I'm taking and finding joy in Jesus because he's here with me. He is near to me. The second thing Paul adds to this is he says, we don't just rejoice always, but we pray always as well. Now, the idea behind this is not that Paul says, hey, listen, that you should just spend all of your life on your knees in prayer. That's not what he is. In fact, Paul was a laborer. He was a guy who worked a lot and loved the idea that we should be doing something with and for our prayers or while we're praying. I love what J.B. Lightfoot says. He says this. He says, prayer is not in the moving of the lips, but in the elevation of the heart to God that the essence of prayer consists. What he's saying there is, listen, prayer is not this thing that we have to be kneeling in the sanctuary or by our bedside, because I know that's how you guys pray every night and every morning. You guys kneel beside your bed and you hold your hands like this and you pray. And so prayer is not always that way. You can't always pray that way. You may pray that way at bedtime and at evening, you know, and when you get up in the morning, but you can't always live beside your bed on your knees praying. But there is this attitude where everywhere we go, everything that we do, we're in this constant communion with God, that God's speaking to us and we're speaking to him. I love how one author writes it. He says it like this, and some of us are old enough to remember what this would actually mean. He says, "It's prayer is like keeping the receiver off the hook." Some of you guys remember those old phones. These young people have no idea. Phones used to be connected to walls. And then they came out with these 20-foot cords that you could almost stretch it around the corner to get away from your parents to talk to your boyfriend or girlfriend. Remember the days before call waiting? Meh, meh, meh. Such memories. And there would be times where you'd fall asleep just listening to what the other one sleep, listening to the other one sleep. I didn't do that, Pastor Darrell. No. I live in the cell phone generation. I've just heard stories, all right? But it's that principle that God has access, ongoing access to your life. And you have ongoing access to the voice of God in heaven as he's constantly living within us every day and this communion is taking place. I love Brother Lawrence. Brother Lawrence was a man in the 16th century who was walking through some difficult times in life and was at a place where he really felt the pain and the regret of his past. And so he actually committed himself into a monastery. And whenever he moved into this monastery, one of the things that he did is he committed himself not to speak but to commune with God. And he was assigned to the kitchen where he was cutting up vegetables and preparing the food for his superiors. And he created such an intimacy with God during those times that he became the envy of everyone else on campus. And so they began to interview him about his times in prayer. And what he really just began to say is, I take these moments to invite God into my day. That I'm constantly, I don't want to hang up the phone and say the prayer's over and I'm going to move on. It's that I carry the phone like a cell phone into this thing and I'm just constantly in communion with God because that's how God wants us to move. And so we live in this place of rejoicing always, but we pray always. And then thirdly, we give thanks in all things. This was a phrase that I've heard pastors speak on again many times. And pastor would say to us, you have to understand the prepositions. The preposition doesn't say give thanks for all things. It says give thanks in all things. We don't give God thanks for the difficulties and the trials that we're walking through. We don't give God thanks for the sickness. We don't give God thanks for the moments where we're walking through divorce. But in that moment, we still yet find this place that we can give God thanks. If anyone knew about giving God thanks in difficult moments, it was the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul, if you're reading 2 Corinthians chapter 12, he lists the things which he endured, the difficulties, shipwreck, beaten, and persecuted, imprisoned, rejected. You go through this litany of things. It was bitten by a snake. He's a variety of things that Paul went through, but yet he still found this place that if you read his letters, he's constantly looking beyond that and finding God in the midst of the most difficult moments. And he oftentimes leads us to give thanks in those moments where it seems that life is bitter rather than sweet. Now, there's two things I want to leave you with today as we process this passage. And the first one is this, that when we are in these moments, we have to focus on God's promises rather than your problems. Because you're going to have problems, I'm going to have problems, and if we're not careful, what happens is we become so fixated on our situation that we forget God's promises in the middle of it. I love to, I had the opportunity for a while to serve as a police chaplain. And in that process, I began to develop relationship and get to know the jobs and the responsibilities of dispatchers. Can I just tell you that dispatchers are a gift from God? If you're ever in a crisis, if you're ever in one of those moments where you have tragedy, where, and I pray that you never have to call them, where there's a medical emergency or there's a car wreck or there's a criminal involvement where you have to call them and you're waiting for them, the police to show up. But if you ever do, those dispatchers are amazing because they, in the midst of your most tragic moment, whenever we are heightened in our energy and heightened in our, we can't even speak calmly, those dispatchers remain steady and peaceful. They can bring peace in the midst of the most chaotic situation and the greatest tragedy. Oftentimes, they will give you instructions on how to perform CPR, even though you're panicking with the situation that you're immediately in front of. But here's what they don't do. They don't say, "How bad is it?" What they also say is, and I think this is a big one, they repeat this phrase, "Help is on the way. Help is on the way." You see, it is that thing, that which gives them hope, that which gives them this promise that they are seen, that they are heard, that yes, this is a difficult moment. Yes, this is overwhelming, but here's the promise that we have. Help is on the way. And whenever you and I are in the midst of those difficult situations, what we have to understand is that help is on the way. Jesus will come, Paul says. He says that he is coming to us, and he's even near us now, even in the midst of our pain. But here's what happens in my life, maybe not in yours, but here's what happens in my life. In the midst of this, I begin to look at the progress of the situation. And I oftentimes may not see, without focusing on the promise, I can just focus on the problem and where we are in the midst of this problem. And I can begin to allow the progress to overwhelm the process to the place that I begin to judge the product. It's kind of like, if we had a recipe for a cake, the end result, the product of that is a beautiful cake that's going to taste wonderful. But if in 5 minutes into the baking process, I opened up the oven and I pulled this cake out and it's before it's completed the process, guess what would happen? It would be nasty, perhaps even dangerous, toxic to our bodies. But if I will allow the process to be completed, and not be judging it all throughout the progress of this moment and that moment, but say, "God, the process is at work." And in the words of Stephen Furtick, he would say, "Let it cook, let it cook." And you have to let God cook sometimes the situation. But God is in the middle of it. And so we can give thanks. And how part of how we do that is we focus on God's promises. You know, some of God's promises that, "Lord, you keep in perfect peace the one whose mind is stayed on thee," Isaiah. One of my favorites is, "God, you will never leave us nor forsake us." In fact, I want to give you the second one. The second one is this, that we have to focus on the reality of God's presence rather than the present reality. Sometimes we have to just pull out those promises of God and say, "God, you've promised that you're with me even in the midst of this pain, that you promised that you would never leave me nor forsake me, even though it feels like you've left me and forsaken me." I think back to these passages, and this promise of God's presence with us is all throughout Scripture. You go back to Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 23. It's one of the first places that we see this, and it's at that transition between Moses and Joshua. Remember, Moses was the ultimate leader. He's the one that led them out of pain. He led them out of slavery. He led them out of Egypt. He led them in the wilderness. He was a figure that they looked to, but he was nearing his time of ending on earth and going into eternity. And he pauses there to speak to Joshua, and he gives these words from the Lord to Joshua. And he says this, "Be strong and courageous, for you will bring the sons of Israel into the land which I swore to them." Listen, what is he saying? "I've promised you this. But here's the new promise that I'm giving to you, Joshua. I will be with you." You see, sometimes in your life and in my life, when we're going through this process, this transition, and we're looking at the progress of it, not pulling back and allowing God to complete the process, we're saying, God, where are you? It's interesting that if you fast forward to Matthew chapter 28, verse 20, if you're following our reading program, which I know that all of you are, you're going to read it in a couple of days. And it's at another one of those transitional moments where Jesus has just been resurrected from the dead. He's speaking to his disciples before he ascends into heaven, and he's saying to them, hey, listen, this is another one of those pivotal moments where you are accustomed to me being with you physically, and you're overwhelmed and you're stressed, and you don't know how you're going to move beyond this moment because I'm about to be gone from you, and life is reaching another transition, and you probably don't know how to give thanks in this season. But here's what I say to you. I am with you always, even to the ends of the earth. You see, sometimes in the midst of our situation, we can't just look at our present reality. We have to see God's presence and the reality of his presence in the midst of our present reality. I love one final verse of Hebrews chapter 13. The writer of Hebrews is again summing up his words and his instructions to his readers. And he's saying a number of bullet points in this verse, in this chapter. And he gets to verse 5, and he reaches back to the Old Testament. He reaches back to Deuteronomy, and he brings a fresh promise to those people. And he says again to them, I will never desert you, nor will I ever abandon you. I am with you. Watch what happens with the next verse, verse 6. So that we confidently say, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? Can I just say for just a moment, if you and I, in the midst of most of our situations, could stand up with confidence and say, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? What are we saying? God, the reality is that you're right here in the middle of this with me. Even in the midst of my present reality, I'm not focusing on what's happening to me. I'm focusing on who is with me in this moment. This passage is so beautiful because when we look at this, we have to say to ourselves that gratitude sometimes seems unreasonable. But we give thanks for the nearness of God. Because God is near with you in the midst of this situation. I love this word, and this week as I was really processing this, I came to this word in the Greek. In the Greek, this word thanks is the word Eucharisto, which is where we get our word the Eucharist. How many of you know the Eucharist? The Eucharist is the Lord's Supper. It's communion. What an interesting combination that we would give thanks for Christ's suffering. Imagine with me for just a moment that we are led to this moment in Jesus' life where Jesus has been in great communion with the Father, and he's led all the way to the end, but he's now on the last night of his life. He's sitting with his disciples. He's going to pick out the one who's going to betray him. He's about to prepare them for what's to come, that in just a few hours, he's going to give his life. And here's what Jesus says in Luke 22, verse 15. The scripture says this, and he said to them, I have eagerly desired. What a strange combination. I have passionately longed for this moment. What is this moment? To eat this Passover. Why this Passover? Because this is the fulfillment of the Passover. But the fulfillment of this Passover means that I have to go to the Garden of Gethsemane. It means that I have to be rejected, that I have to be beaten, I have to be mocked and ridiculed. I have to give my life on the cross of Calvary. I will be crucified. I will be separated from my Father, not because of my sin, but because of your sin. And Jesus says to them, I've longed to eat this. I've eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you. This is a big moment. It's a painful moment, but I've longed to be there with you in the midst of this before I suffer. And from this word thanksgiving in the Greek comes. I want to say it like this. It takes intentionality to say, Lord, I don't know how to give you thanks for this, but I will give you thanks in this. I could just say this, that there's going to be some times in your life and in my life where we cannot give God thanks for this. But by his grace and mercy and his nearness, we can give God thanks in this. Would you stand with me? Brother Lawrence, in his life before his transition, was walking through a very difficult season. And how many of you have ever just felt the weight of your failures just rest upon your shoulders? The constant times that you've failed, that you've let down others and you've let down yourself, and you're just this remorse. And Brother Lawrence was in this moment, and as he was in this moment, he came upon a tree that was dead. It was the winter time and the dead of winter, and so it had lost its leaves, and it looked like there was no form of life within it. And he began to say, that tree looks like my life. That in this stage, I have nothing good, and it seems like the all is lost and all is dead. And some of you may be in this place. The scripture tells us that if the Spirit of God is not living in us, that we are spiritually dead. And there is no hope, because we are just living with remorse and the regret of our failures and our sin. And maybe that's what you walked in here with today. Maybe you feel like Brother Lawrence, in the sense that your weight of your world is crashing in upon you, and there is no reprieve from the guilt that you feel. And maybe you stepped in here today saying, I've just coming to see if God can do anything in my life. And I want to tell you that the God of creation can not only bring dead things back to life, but he can fill your life with the greatest joy. He can make the things that seem dead in your life blossom again and bear fruit. And so my first prayer this morning that I want to pray is for someone in this room, or someone who's watching online. And maybe your prayer is, I just need Jesus to come and make dead things live. Spiritually, I'm broken and I'm dead on the inside. And I don't know how God can do it. And it's been the weight of my decisions and of my choices that's led me to this. But I need a Savior. With every head bowed and every eye closed, today, if you're in this place and you feel like that tree, you feel dead and lifeless, and you need Jesus Christ to come in and to bring you back to life, to take that which is spiritually dead and to bring it to life, I want to ask you just to raise your hand with me this morning. I want to pray with you. If that's you, would you raise your hand? 1, 2, 3. Amen. 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 Father God, with these hands that are uplifted up across this room, God, I come in faith believing that the simplicity of our faith, of placing our confidence and our trust in you, Lord, that you can make dead things live again. Jesus, the scripture says, if we will confess our sins, that you are faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, that you, Lord Jesus, can take away the dead things from our life. And God, that you can breathe new life through the power of your Spirit, that we become alive again. Paul, as John would say, Lord, we are reborn into the kingdom. Lord, you've given us a new life. And so, Lord, the way that happens is that we believe in our hearts that Jesus Christ is the only way to new life. That we believe, Jesus, that you are the way, the truth, and the life. There's no way to the Father. There's no way to God except for through you. And so we declare you as Lord of our life. And with our mouths, we confess you as our Lord and Savior. Knowing, Father, that it's not by works of righteousness, lest we can do. It's not by us being here or in this room or all the good things we can do. It's only by faith in who Jesus is that we can have life today. And so, Lord, with those hands that have been lifted up and prayed this prayer in faith, God, I ask right now that you would cleanse them and purify them and that you would fill them with your Spirit. I pray, Father, that you would bring dead things back to life, that broken dreams would be restored, that broken relationships would be restored. Father, that futures and hopes would be set before them, God, that the impossible would become possible because of what you're doing in their life, not by their works, not by their righteousness, but because of your Spirit bringing them to pass in their life. And God, I pray that you would break off this bitterness and that you would fill their lives with the sweetness. Your word is like honey, Father, and I pray that you would fill them with the sweetness of your word and that they would live in the truth of your promises. In Jesus' name we pray. Can we give God praise this morning for those hands, those lives that were changed? Amen. Father, we thank you so much for what you've accomplished with your word and your presence this morning. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would seal this word, that you would seal this message, you would seal this moment in our hearts, God, that whenever the enemy brings all that he has to bring against us, that we will have this foundation of hope, that Jesus, you are trustworthy, you are faithful, and you are our hope, and our trust is in you. And so, Lord, we will rejoice always, we will pray always, and we will give thanks in all things, for this is the will of God for us in Christ Jesus. Lord, we thank you for what you've accomplished today. May you take us forth and use us in your name and by your power, in Christ's name. And everyone said, amen. Love one another as I have loved you. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples. If you have love one for another, even so come, Lord Jesus. God bless you. Have a great week.